going to do Jesus's temptation in the wilderness. So we are going to sing Me Alone. This is a call and response. Marilyn, could you go to the next slide, please?
Marilyn.
Next, there we go. So Jacqueline is our leader. She'll sing a line, we sing it back to her. She sings the second line, we sing it back to her. And we'll just sing this for a while. This comes to us from Jamaica.
Yeah, it's on. Just not coming through the. Oh, here, yeah, I'll get. Go ahead. Try it again.
Okay. Are we on yet? No? Do you have a green light?
Yeah. Go ahead. Try it.
I'm trying again.
Oh. Okay.
There we go.
Oh, try the lavalier, Emily, please.
Is this one
your thing? No. Okay.
Okay, we're gonna stick with the handle. It's okay, you keep that one. Thank you. Well, hi. Welcome. I'm so happy that you all are here, whether you're here in person or online. You are so welcome to this church. Welcome to El Sobrante United Methodist Church. My name is Reverend Emily Higgins Jones. I have the honor of serving as your lead pastor. I'm here, each one here. We are in a wonderful series about what happened during the last week of Jesus' life, looking at different stories to help us understand a little bit more of what it was like during that time. So each week we're focusing on a particular story. We are putting ourselves into the picture, hence all of the frames around and understanding our different paintings that are all around the sanctuary as well. And we are having some tough times with the microphones today. But we will continue.
We need to turn off the sound too.
We continue on our journey through Lent as we step inside the story of a teacher who turned
Maryland.
Upside down. We put ourselves in the picture of Holy Week, so that we might closer look and let the ancient story for the call to follow the teacher of Jesus.
Do a wide shot.
Into the story. Susceptible to those who want to trap him, to twist his words, get him to say something damn. He cannot turn from his vocation. He is not only a master teacher, but also a prophet and a voice of the divine. It is his ability to draw the people to his teachings that poses a threat, a challenge to the authorities. We place ourselves in the crowd this week to be moved and motivated by Jesus for our lives, to get a faithful perspective. What would we have seen? What would we have heard? What would we have felt? What do we do now?
Thank you.
Lent is traditionally a time where we do a little bit of work on ourselves, where we look and we acknowledge the harm that we've caused, the pain that we've felt. And so each week for our year during Lent, we take part in a prayer of confession. Let us pray together.
We come here to encounter the teachings of Jesus. Many wanted to destroy him for his teachings, and sometimes we too find that his words challenge us, calling us to more than we think we can be or do. Forgive us, O God. Let us be shaped into a new people, made in the mold of justice, not the sands of Caesar's soil. You entered our story through Jesus. Now help us to enter fully into the story of your kingdom.
For our opening hymn, we're going to be singing "We Will Take What You Offer," which comes to us from John Bell and the Iona community. And Marilyn, if you could go to the next slide, please. So this, you can see the set of words there. We will take what you offer, we will live by your word, we will love one another and be fed by you, Lord. And then we sing all of that a second time, and that's once through the keys. Then the second time, we're going to sing "Led" instead of "Fed." So we will take what you offer, we will live by your word, we will love one another, and be led by the Lord instead of "Fed." But if we are confused and sing something different than your neighbor, this is okay. The important thing is we are being fed at table this morning, and we are also looking out to how we can be led by Jesus and his example of taking risks.
Encouraged and loved by a God who wants you to live fully. Let us enter the passion of Christ and pass the peace of Christ with one another. Peace be with you. Say it to your neighbor.
Peace be with you. And also with you. Peace.
And peace to all that's online. We have a fun story for those of you who are at home. You can come a little bit closer to the screen. We're going to stay up here today, so if you want to just come and sit around me here. I can't sit on the floor right now. You can do it. I believe in you.
Let's get by Robin.
You guys want to come sit right here in front of me here? Perfect. Way to go. You got to face me though. Hey, how's it going, guys? I hurt my back, so I'm sitting up here today. Otherwise, I have to join the ground. You've got Jacqueline there. Oh, hello. Glad to see you today. So, today we're continuing in Lent. That's a special time of year. You've got your family there today. So, we've been this all around. I love it. It's a time where we can get closer with God. Okay, that's what Lent is. And so in today's story we hear from the Bible, there are some people who are trying to trick Jesus. Do you like being tricked?
No.
I don't like being tricked very much. It's not very nice. But just for, you know, for fun, I'm going to try and trick you guys in a fun way. Okay? So I'm going to read our story. And when you hear something that you think isn't part of the Bible, you're going to make a fun noise. You ready? It's going to be a buzzer noise. Can you make that noise? One, two, three. There you go. I know, I would tell you really cool if money had a puzzle. No, instead, who was on the coin?
Caesar.
The emperor of Rome. The big kahuna, the guy in charge of everything. Well, that's actually correct. Jesus said to them, give to Caesar what belongs to Caesar and to God what belongs to God. They had completely outsmarted Jesus. Right? That's not true. Jesus outsmarted them. They couldn't trap him with his words in front of the people. And they were astonished by Jesus' answer, and so they performed a Broadway musical. No? Actually, they were speechless. Do we have this one back on? Jesus was the kindest, most loving person who ever lived. Yet people were still trying to catch him and trick him to say something that he shouldn't. That's not very nice. There are always going to be those who are more interested in seeing our mistakes than seeing the good that we're trying to do. We can keep trying to do good things, all right? That's really important that we keep trying, even when people aren't being very nice, okay? So we follow Jesus' example by living the best lives we can, no matter what others say. You think you can do that? No matter what people say, can you be nice? I don't know, it's kind of hard. All right, so I'm gonna have a say a prayer. Let's all take a deep breath in and out. So we're gonna say a prayer. Can you repeat after me? Okay. Loving God,
give us the courage
to live our best lives out loud.
So that we are truly
living your story.
Yeah.
Amen. Thanks for being here today. I'm so happy to see you.
If you want to do the this and the camera.
Yes, that's it. She's going to help us.
I was getting some feedback. So.
She does. Help her find her seat. All right, you guys can go on back. It's so much fun having you be here. Buzz, you need to be practicing.
Give to Caesar what belongs to Caesar, and give to God what belongs to God. Please join us in singing Sea Keepers.
Thank you. tested was nothing new for Jesus. During his ministry, he was FaceTimed and again with the situations in which he was asked to defend his teachings against the way we've always done it. Indeed, his entire ministry was preceded by temptation. Just after John baptized him, he was led into a wilderness journey and was tempted to use his status as God's son for ends not becoming of a humble servant. No wonder Jesus could recognize deceit in the Pharisees' spies and the Herodians' questions in Jerusalem that last week. He had experienced it before in the form of evil incarnate. Then the Spirit led Jesus up into the wilderness so that the devil might tempt him. After Jesus had fasted for 40 days and 40 nights, he was starving. The tempter came to him and said, "Since you are God's son, command these stones to become bread." Jesus replied, "It is written, people won't live only by bread, but by every word spoken by God." After that, the devil brought him into the holy city and stood him at the highest point of the temple. He said to him, "Since you are God's son, throw yourself down, for it is written, I will command my angels concerning you, and they will take you up in their hands, so that you won't hit your foot on a stone." Jesus replied, "Again, it's written, don't test the Lord your God." Then the devil brought him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. He said, "I'll give you all of these if you bow down and worship me." Jesus responded, "Go away, Satan, because it's written, you will worship the Lord your God and serve only him." The devil left him, and angels came and took care of him.
I think one of the things that Jesus calls us to is to become our true authentic selves, where the image of God shines forth brightly like the light. And so we are going to, the band is going to sing a song called The Motions, which talks about being real.
I don't want to go one more.
Jesus kept showing up at the temple that week, even after the skirmish at the temple market. You would think he'd lay back, lay off, lay low, stay out of the way. His name was on the watch list for sure. I hear that even when he was born, he was perceived as a threat to Herod. That's what I hear. It was before my time here, though. My allegiance is to Herod. And I've been placed here to help oversee the Jews this week. This Passover party here in the city has me really nervous. This place is packed. We were instructed to see if we could get this Jesus to say something that would prove he means to harm the state, that he will encourage people to break Roman law, or that he will create a rebellion that will end ugly. So, we were instructed to catch this guy saying something. Something that we can charge him with. They teamed us up with some Pharisees, Jewish priests who oversee the rules for their own people. These particular priests, though, they're no more than spies, I would say. They want him shut down as bad as Herod, but they lay it on thick, getting cozy, telling him what an amazing teacher he is. I decided to stay out of the way. It actually makes my stomach turn, all of this deceitful stuff. I'm sure this guy will go off the rails and end up in prison, or worse. I just hope it's over quick. What? What did he say? Well, this is something. He's got those Pharisees reaching into their pockets to get denarii. Huh. Well, I'll be. This guy's good. Nothing wrong with that answer. They won't be able to get him today. Actually, I'd have to say I'm curious. There's something about him. I wouldn't mind hearing more. Perhaps I'll volunteer to keep an eye on him. Although what I really want is just to be near him. Just to hear what else he has to say. There's something about him.
Thank you.
begin by inviting you to think for a moment. I know, dangerous to do. All awake, you're able to think a little bit. Who are the people in your life that have been your role models? Think back, especially to your childhood. Maybe they are people who have been influential in your life. People who made you the person you are today. Can you think of a few people? You don't have to say them out loud. Just can you think of those people for a moment? Just hold them in your mind's eye. Are there people from maybe outside of your family? Perhaps a pastor? Or perhaps a teacher? I know several of the people that I think of are teachers. And I know many people in our wonderful congregation are indeed teachers. In fact, you're all teachers in some capacity. You all have your own vocation of teaching. And to those that have served as teachers, I just want to say thank you. You all are amazing. As teachers, you have the hardest and most underpaid job that there is. And you are the most life-changing. I think teachers deserve a special reward for everything they do, have done, and especially during COVID, right? I think of several teachers who have been very important to me, especially in high school. I'm lucky to say that I've had a wonderful high school experience, and not many people can say that, I know. I went to Mercy High School in Burlingame. I went back about a month ago to speak at the school's career day, which was a lot of fun, especially going to an all-girls Catholic school and telling them about how I'm a pastor. It was a really interesting experience. It really felt like a homecoming to me. My high school really was a home. But many of the teachers I have are no longer there. The legacy they've kept can still be felt. I had one teacher who gave her insight into why she loves to vote and be first in line at the polling place. She got so excited about it that it totally rubbed off on me. And I started getting really excited about going to vote because of her passion. I had another teacher, that's a reminder to vote this week, don't forget. Okay? All right. I had another teacher who would watch all the Oscar Best Picture nominees, and we would discuss them at length. We had so much fun doing this. And now I take part in an Oscar party every year. Another teacher and I connected during my entrance interview for the school, and she and I still keep in touch. She is very much a kindred spirit to who I am. She has taught me more than I can recognize. Teachers have this way, right, of being inspirational, even if it's not about the subjects that they're teaching. They have a way of showing us a different way of thinking. They are generally the first adults outside of our family to be influential to us, right? And that's where Jesus enters the scene. The teacher at the temple. In the chapter for the book this week, Amy Jo Levine actually looks at three different stories that we'll look at more in small groups this week. But today we're focusing on the teaching about taxation. So that's three current events we're talking about now, right? We have voting, the Oscars are next week, and taxes are coming up. Anyway, Jesus taught at the temple and attracted many people. It wasn't just the disciples, right? You heard from someone else who was there. It was all kinds of people. For those of you who were here last week, who was welcome at the temple?
Everybody.
Everyone, right? We learned about the temple. Make sure if you haven't had a chance to watch last week's service, make sure you go and do that. Your minds will be blown about the temple and flipping tables story. I'm still recovering from it. But Angel Levine, author of the book, tells us that teaching is a risk no matter where you are, even in the temple, where everyone is welcome. She says, there's always the possibility, this is from her perspective as a professor at Vanderbilt, there's always the possibility that someone in the classroom will misunderstand what I've said and come up with something completely off the wall. Then the student goes out into the world, gets up in the pulpit, and announces, Professor Levine taught me, blah, blah, blah. It's terrifying. Teaching always carries risk. She even refers to the Epistle of James that says, not many of you should become teachers. Jesus is taking a huge risk by teaching in the temple. What is he risking? Being misunderstood, being arrested, getting a bad reputation, becoming very unpopular, right? And while Jesus is teaching, people come forward to ask questions. As was already talked about, those asking the questions were really just trying to trip him up. Levine compares these people to those in her class that sit in the back row and ask ridiculous questions to show off or act out, which is totally accurate for these guys. She says that she answers those questions in a way that they never ask such obnoxious questions again. She says she takes her cues from Jesus. There are three things that you need to do when you have a question like this. One, figure out what is behind the question. Two, know the scriptures well. And three, make sure you respond with kindness, respect, and empathy. I'm sure that many teachers here can empathize with that struggle of how to respond to ridiculous questions, right? And Jesus is a master teacher, so masterful that he can take on teaching about taxes, right? Because even in Jesus' time, the only two things that were certain were
death and
taxes and death, to quote Benjamin Franklin. And we're all thinking about our taxes this time of year. I hope we try not to, that's also. But we wonder about our taxes, don't we? We wonder where the money goes. You ever think about that?
No.
Yeah. Schools, military, international aid, local infrastructure, salaries, libraries. Lattes? Sure. All right, does our money go? It kind of gets overwhelming, right? So we choose not to think about it too much. We just don't know, and it's hard for us to even begin to talk about it. Then imagine how difficult it must be when you are paying taxes toward a despot, right? To the Roman Empire. The question changes to not what are my taxes going towards, but instead, should we even pay taxes? What would God think? So yeah, these people are asking about taxes because they know it's a trap. Jesus will look bad no matter what he answers, right? What do you think would happen if he said, don't pay your taxes?
Ooh.
What would happen? He'd be arrested even quicker, right? It would not be a very popular thing to do. They wanted to find an excuse to arrest him, remember? The powers that be. If he said, go ahead, pay your taxes, what would that do?
People would be mad.
Would be very upset.
Zealots would be upset. What do you think? Anyone else? It would seem like he was contradicting himself. Mm-hmm. I heard something else?
He
People would say, why? Yeah. And also, it would just really alienate all those who are fighting the oppression of Rome. Right? Those who are also risking their lives to fight for freedom, to fight for the rights of everyone. Levine parallels this to those in the American Revolution that said taxation without representation is tyranny. Right? So a pretty similar kind of thing. So it would be like telling those early Americans, no, just pay your taxes and get it over with, right? We know how that turned out. The question becomes, can we be true to God if we pay Rome taxes that pay for Roman temples and armies? What a loaded question. And Jesus knows it too. And so, this masterful attempt here, he turns the question back to his questioners to determine what they think belongs to God and what they think belongs to Caesar. Hey, we answer a question with a question, you can't go wrong, right? And this was actually a tradition in Jesus' time, because so much of what was happening in the temple and by scholars was that they were debating and asking questions of each other. And what were they debating? Great question, thank you for asking. They were debating the commandments. How many commandments were there?
10.
What'd you say? 630. Ah, so 613. Yeah, not just 10. Should I do a sermon on that sometime? Just read them all for you? Yeah, sounds like so much fun, doesn't it? Yeah, there were more than 10. There were 613. But they debated over which are the most important ones. Right? So when Jesus was asked this question, he was not surprised by it. And his answer would not have been a surprise to those who heard it either, because he's citing scripture, taking number two of what Levine recommends. He cites Deuteronomy 6, 4 through 5, which is part of Judaism's daily liturgy. And then he adds good old Leviticus, Leviticus 19, 18. And Jesus is here to fulfill the law. That's what he talks about, right? That he's there to fulfill the law with his teachings, with his new commandment. What is this new commandment that he teaches? Anybody? Exactly. This is not a trick question. Love God, love your neighbor. Right? If you're remembering that one now? Yeah, it sounds familiar, I hope. And when you take this in the context of where Jesus is headed, it becomes even more powerful. His journey to the cross just takes on a new meaning. That Jesus is showing his love for God and others by willingly sacrificing his life. So when he says, render to Caesar what is Caesar's, and give to God what is God's, does that clear it up for you? It's still confusing, isn't it? It's a weird phrase. And I'm not here to give you the answer, sorry. Because like all good teachers, we're supposed to get you thinking about what this means for you based on what I've said. God is faithful to always provide us teachers who come with a message for our times, relevant to the issues of the day and the culture. We all have those teachers. And in our prayers to the people today, we'll be honoring those who have been leaders, who have taught us things. We need teachers who challenge us, who get us to think about stuff, not just give us the answers, right? We don't get an answer key. Do any of you have an answer key? Can you share it with us? No? Okay. Teachers give us answers without giving us answers, right? And these teachers are often people who are risking the challenge to teach. Jesus, in the first century, taught more than obedience to rules. He taught character building with his words and actions, character that reflected God's own. Jesus taught compassion by his actions and words. Jesus taught a person's station in life has no bearing on their value to God. Jesus taught forgiveness is available to all people for past wrongs, past ways of living, for those thoughts and behaviors that were hurtful to oneself or to others. Jesus taught us that it is okay to ask questions. And it is okay to speak truth to hypocrisy and truth to power structures. And most importantly, that not all questions need a response. And so we give thanks for those teachers that are out there teaching us so many things, teaching us that there is more than right and wrong, right? We all have the opportunity to teach. Parents are teachers, friends are teachers, even students can be teachers when we take risks, right? To talk about what is right, what is just. That's countercultural, don't you think? Right? We are loving and living rather than getting our way or trying to trick people into things. Because ultimately, for Christians, there's always another option. We always have a third way that helps us to think outside of what is good and what is evil. We are looking at what is love. What does that love mean? And so we risk it ourselves. We risk following Jesus, the teacher, into this new way of thinking. He promises us that through this way of thinking, we will have eternal life through God's love. And I say thanks be to God for that. Preach in the pursuit of right living and right relationship. You can enjoy the pictures that will be scrolling to think about how all of these people have been teachers. Lord, in your mercy, hear our continue to be with us in times of need when we are really struggling. You are our teacher, our moral compass, our great wisdom, one who is able to be with us in times of need and in times of joy. And we ask, O God, humbly, that you give those who are suffering peace, those who are mourning comfort, those who are ill or injured, your healing mercy. We remember that your Son taught us so many things. Your Son taught us how to live, and perhaps even how to die. And, O God, he taught us the prayer that we say every week to remember all of these things that he has taught us. Whatever language or word in, you are comfortable with. Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. We give thanks for this time together. We show ways of giving in so many different ways, through a hug, through our gifts of ministry and service, and through our monetary means. These are symbols of all of the wonderful things that you all have done, continue to give, and it all comes from God. We give thanks for that. Please stand in body and spirit to sing our doxology.
Oh,
Father, to give thanks to you, divine artist, creator of heaven and earth. Your brushstrokes evoked the whole of your palette, making all creation into your colorful images. You breathed into us the breath of life and framed us with the story of love. When we turn away and our love fades, like a work of art long neglected, you restore us to original glory. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Thank you.
to open your palms upward like this. Take a moment to be still, to freeze the frame of this moment. It is here that we come to be transformed by God's grace into the beauty God intends. Know that all we must do is open ourselves to receive. The master artist of this moment, of all moments, is at work to restore us even now. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and cup. Make them be for us the love of Christ, so that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by this love. Now I invite you to either touch the person next to you if you have consent, or just reach out a hand to your side to all the people around you. Take a look around, for as you look upon the body of Christ, you do indeed turn your eyes upon Jesus. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ and one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever.
I'm coming back.
I invite you to join me in the prayer of the community. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery, in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
I invite you to remain standing for our closing song, Cry of My Heart. One, two, three, four.
Thank you.
see. Lisa was very happy because the camera angle had Carl in it.
What?
Because Lisa was happy because she could see Carl in it when he had the band picture up. Because he's usually hidden back there.
Hey, Ron. Hope them fingers get better.
Thank you.
couldn't find my scarf this morning. Oh, it's okay. It's okay. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Sometime. Yeah, sometime I will. What happened to your ear?
You know the same doctor that
good catch. Very good catch.
It was, huh?
Yes.
My feet stick on there.
Yeah. Recording. Stop.